ओम शांति शांति शांति। ओम वसुदेव सुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं। असतो मा सद्गमय, तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय, मृत्योर्मामृतंगमय। ओम शांति शांति शांति। लेट अस ऑफर अवर सैल्यूटेशंस टू लॉर्ड कृष्ण, द सन ऑफ वसुदेव देवकी, द ब्लिस ऑफ देवकी, the spiritual preceptor of the mankind. Let us pray to him to lead us from the unreal to the real, to lead us from the darkness of ignorance to the light of knowledge, to lead us from death to immortality. We have been studying the yoga of wisdom. Verse number 42, Yami Mam Pushpitam वाचम प्रवदन्त्य विपश्चितः वेद वादरताः पार्थ नान्यस्ति इति वादिनः। अर्जुन, दोस हु आर नॉन डिस्क्रिमिनेटिंग, हु आर फैसिनेटेड बाय द कर्मकांड ऑफ द वेदर्स, हु आर्ग्यू दैट देयर इज नथिंग अदर देन दिस, अटर दीज फ्लावरी वर्ड्स। कामात्मानः स्वर्गपरा जन्म कर्म फलप्रदाम क्रिया विशेष बहुलाम भोगेश्वर्य गतिं प्रति। पर्सन्स हूज माइंड्स आर फुल ऑफ डिजायर्स विथ हेवन एज द हाईएस्ट गोल अटर दीज फ्लावरी वर्ड्स अबाउट मेनी स्पेशल रिचुअल्स लीडिंग टू बेटर बर्थ फॉर द अटेनमेंट ऑफ प्लेजर एंड पावर। That's called Bhogeshwarya. So people generally seek pleasures and powers. So they are constantly in samsara in order to fulfill the desires. They keep on coming on this earth planet to work out their desires. Bhogeshwarya prasaktanam tayapahrita chetasam vyavasayatmika buddhihi samadhau navidhiyate. For those who pursue power and pleasure exclusively, whose minds have been robbed of discrimination by those flowery words, well ascertained understanding, that is vyavasayatmika buddhi, doesn't take place in their minds. Vedas contain both karma kanda and jnana kanda. There are certain people who study Vedas but get hooked on to the karma kanda portion only. They are not interested in the jnana kanda or Vedanta at all. Although Vedanta is also an important part of the Vedas, this Jnanakanda is very important. The only focus on the Karmakanda, people get fascinated by the rituals enjoined in the Karmakanda for the results they produce in samsara. Their mind do not go beyond that. Lacking in discrimination as they are, these persons cannot distinguish between what is important and what is not, even after studying the Vedas. They are confused and are deeply attached to Bhogeshwarya. Bhoga is pleasure and Aishwarya is power, overlordship. You can see, observe the people in the world, how they behave. each one projects his ego so much to show up their deep attachment to pleasures and power. These persons swear by the ritualistic portions of the Vedas and argue that if Vedas themselves recommend rituals for gaining Bhogeshwarya, what is wrong in seeking Bhogeshwarya? These people argue that actions which get them Bhogeshwarya are the only important actions, and therefore they are totally committed to those Vedic rituals which promise such pleasures. They also argue there is no goal higher than heaven. Reaching heaven is a very important objective on their agenda, as important to them as worldly power and pleasures are when they are alive. For such people, moksha means merely gaining heaven after death. These are the persons whose minds are full of desires, kamatmanaha. They have many, many desires to be fulfilled when they are alive. After that, they have desires for heaven. For them, there is no place like heaven, and the possibility of not being able to get there torment their mind a great deal. They also seek better birth, jnana karma palapradam, in the next life. They wish to be born in a rich and regal environment. They have no interest in life other than Bhogeshwarya, heaven and better birth. For instance, they have no interest in the Atman and Atman Jnanam. Their minds are completely robbed of discrimination. So these persons who lack discrimination tell you with a missionary zeal how one can get to heaven and how one can be born in a royal family like the British monarchy or in the family of billionaire, by performing certain rules given in the Karma Kanda of the Vedas. So their mind is totally focused on the pleasures. Their mind do not go beyond that. They always think they are born to enjoy the life. So one must get into life of pleasures and enjoy the life fully in the youth stage. Let us not worry about spiritual theme. This is not a time when all the pleasures are over, then we shall think of spiritual ideas, which can never happen. For most people, it is very pleasant to hear about comfort and luxury in life. They are delighted by all actions that get them worldly power and worldly pleasures. For instance, when someone talks of how comfortable and pleasant the life is in USA, people who do not reside in USA find it very enchanting. Their minds get carried away when they hear about such things, more so when they are couched in flowery words. The persons who are obsessed by Bhogeshwarya, heaven and better birth, revel in the relevant Vedavakyas, Vedavadrataha. These people constantly talk about their beliefs and their commitment to such beliefs in flowery words, Pushpitam Vacham. They tell you and frequently quote the relevant passages from the Vedas in support of the Vedic rituals of interest to them. They also try to convince all others with flowery words that there is nothing more to life other than the rituals that they espouse. Being obsessed by these rituals, these persons talk of nothing else. philosophy doesn't appeal to them. Knowledge about the self doesn't appeal to them. They are not bothered about such things. When the mind is obsessed by such fancies, it gets robbed of its discrimination and it tends to spread out. It cannot focus. These people fully understand what are dharma, artha and kama, and pursue them with a single-minded devotion. For them, moksha means attaining heaven, and with this confused understanding, they get exceedingly interested in it also. Dharma, artha and kama are results in samsara, whereas moksha gives liberation from samsara. One requires a measure of discrimination to be able to regard liberation from samsara as a right goal in life, and discrimination in those persons is conspicuous by its absence. Lacking discrimination, they only have a confused understanding of their priorities in life. Most of the people think that their priority in life should be how they can become very rich and attain high position in the society. That's all their priority. They don't want to think about the reality governing the man's destiny. Vyavsayatmika buddhi means a well ascertained understanding of priorities. Vedavadarataha do not have vyavsayatmika buddhi. They are confused about what they should be seeking in life. They have too many things on their plate. Priorities become a problem. When there are too many things to be accomplished and enjoyed, the buddhi of such persons spreads out into many branches. Their minds minder. The vyavsayatmika buddhi cannot take place in the minds which minder. Vyavsayatmika buddhi asmin samadho na vidyate. Verse number 45. Traigunya vishaya veda nistraigunyo bhava arjuna nidvandvo nitya sattvastho niryoga kshema atmavan. Arjun, the karmakanda of Vedas is related to the three gunas of Maya. Transcending the gunas, having no desires, being free from the sway of the opposites, be always established in sattva, be unconcerned about your yogakshema, and be the master of yourself. Vedas contain, in addition to karmakanda, the Vedanta also. But the persons who lack discrimination are interested only in the karmakanda, which reveals a variety of rituals, all of which promise bhoga and aishwarya. Bhoga and aishwarya results in samsara. They are the products of the three gunas of maya. Traigunya vishaya. Arjuna wanted shreyas, which in the context of the Gita is moksha. Moksha releases one from samsara, whereas the desire for bhoga and aishwarya perpetuates samsara. They are mutually exclusive. The Lord wants Arjun to transcend the three gunas. He should give up the desire for bhoga and aishwarya. Then only it becomes meaningful to seek moksha. Cold and heat, victory and gain, profit and loss, honor and dishonor are examples of opposites. Opposites are the causes of sukh and dukh. Cold and heat, for example, can make you happy or unhappy. If you allow them to do that, then you depend on their presence or absence for your happiness. Similarly, there is pain in defeat and elation in victory, and so forth. You encounter the opposites all the time, all through your life. It is not possible to avoid them at all. What you should do, however, is to try not to come under their spell. You should try to maintain composure in the midst of opposites. Nidvandva bhava. This composure can be gained through the sattva gun. When sattva is predominant, there is composure, discrimination, knowledge, etc. When your commitment is only to knowledge, nitya sattvastha bhava, you can discover yourself to be above the gunas, nistraya gunya. Yoga is to acquire what you do not have. Kshema is to protect what you already have. Yogakshema is your primary drive in life. The concern for Yogakshema encompasses all your egocentric activities. And the concern for Yogakshema is a big problem in every life. The Lord advises Arjuna here to become free from the concern for Yogakshema. One can certainly work for his Yogakshema. There is nothing wrong in working for one's Yogakshema per se. But you must realize that inputs alone are in our control. The result is given by the Lord. You have no control over it. If you can cheerfully accept, therefore, whatever result that comes to you as prasad from the Lord, you would gain composure. This is the attitude of Karma Yoga. In other words, the Lord is advising Arjuna indirectly to cultivate the attitude of Karma Yoga. Atmavan. He is a person whose faculties are always with him. He has his mind and senses always with him. They are with him. He is not with them. He always holds the reins in his hands. He is a master of his senses and mind. Mastering senses and the mind gives composure. Arjuna was disturbed and distressed at the prospect of killing Bhishma, Drona and others. The Lord wants Arjuna to cool down. When you are emotionally distraught, your thinking and understanding would be below optimum. But the task ahead for Arjuna demands all his faculties to be together and alert. Therefore, the Lord wants Arjuna to become an Atmavan. Yavan artha udapane sarvata samplutodake tavan sarveshu vedeshu brahmanasya vijanataha. For a Brahman who has discrimination, who is a jnani, the use of the karma kanda of the Vedas is that much use as are the paltry and tiny ponds when all around them is flooded with water. The rituals described in the karma kanda of the Vedas produce results only in samsara. These are kamya karmas that return you to samsara and its sorrows again and again, repeatedly. The Vedavadratas believes in these Vedic rituals, they believe that when they perform these rituals with Shraddha, they would reap the worldly happiness they seek so ardently. A Brahman is a wise person who is endowed with discrimination. He is very clear in his mind about what he wants. He too seeks happiness, but a different kind of happiness, a happiness that is eternal and absolute. He knows that the outside world doesn't have the ingredients of the happiness that he seeks. He also knows what karmas return you to samsara and what karmas release you from samsara. He is not interested in worldly and heavenly happiness. He is interested in moksha only. The wise person knows that he is the self who is Brahman. Brahman is Satchidananda. Ananda is the very nature of Brahman. When you are the absolute Ananda yourself, why would you look for any other paltry source of Ananda? Therefore, he is not interested in the Vedic rituals. For such a person, Vedic rituals and their limited results are as much use as the water in the submerged ponds and wells, when the entire countryside is flooded with potable rainwater. Why would one search for the submerged ponds and wells for getting water, when he is surrounded by fresh drinking water everywhere? The worldly and even heavenly happiness promised by the Vedas become completely irrelevant and get drowned in the supreme bliss associated with Brahman. Karmanye vadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachan ma karma palahetur bhumate sangostva karmani. The Atmajnani, the person who has realized the Atman, has no more use for what is said in scriptures, even if they are Vedas. He knows that he is himself who created the Vedas. He has no more use for the means. He already attained the end. The choice to you is an action only, but never ever to the fruits thereof. Do not become the cause of the results of actions. May you never have any attachment to inaction. In this materialistic world, we are taught right from childhood that one should have ambitions in life and pursue them with a single-minded perseverance. In the present-day society, selfish action is admired and selfless action is pitied. We never do anything if it does not profit us in some way. Everything that we do must advance some worldly objective or the other for us. Disinterested action is generally considered wasteful. This is what all the management books proclaim. This is what the success-oriented society preaches and practices. We want results and we constantly work for their achievement. When we constantly focus on the outcome or the lack of it, we get worked up over it. When the mind is in turmoil, it cannot concentrate on any task properly. The worry and anxiety invested in the present moments transforms into fear of the future. Tomorrow is only a continuation of today, just as today is a continuation of yesterday. What we invest in the present will decide how prosperous we are going to be in the future. Any action today defines the fruit of this action tomorrow. When we waste the precious present moments in imaginary fears for tomorrow, we do not invest in the present moments efficiently. On the other hand, if you focus your entire store of energy in the present moments and concentrate exclusively on what you do, you give an inspired input. Excellence in input ensures excellence in output. A single-minded devotion to work will always end up in a brilliant success, besides giving job satisfaction. If it is success that you want, then do not strive with a mind ridden with anxiety and fear for the outcome. Even in this materialistic world, focusing on the input exclusively with no thought of the output, as in Karma Yoga, is very essential for success. The Lord says here, your choice in action, but never in its results. Mahapaleshu Kadachan. The result is determined by me, Lord Krishna says. This does not mean that one should perform every action without expecting a result. No one performs any action without expecting a result. When one undertakes to do something, he expects a result, even though he knows that he has no control over the result. This expectation of a result, which is quite natural, is not a problem. The problem comes only when you get attached to the result. The word adhikara actually means the right to choose a particular option out of several options available to you. Here, adhikara therefore means choice. You can decide what work you want to do and how you propose to do it. That's your right. You are not, unfortunately, in a position to choose the result that you want. You are helpless with reference to the result. The result is decided in accordance with the law of cause and effect. This law was not authored by anyone here. It is Ishvara's law. He alone decides the result of every action in the world. You are just an individual with limited knowledge, with limited power, and ever so many desires, your countless likes and dislikes to be fulfilled. All karmas you do are meant for fulfilling your raga dvesh, commonly called desires. What you want is kama, desire. What you want is defined in terms of either raga or dvesha. Raga dveshas alone decide your actions. All karmas are undertaken to produce the desired results. Since you perform a particular karma to produce a specific result, it appears that you have figured out which karma would produce which result. If you are thinking a person, you would very soon find out that what you figured out is not really as predictable as you thought it is. What you want is one thing and what you get is not exactly what you wanted. Frequently it is quite the opposite. And you are helpless about this. Your power and knowledge are limited. This is the status of the jiva. You do have a choice, but only over the action. You have none over the result. You perform the karma and the result is taken care of. If you had power over the result, then every one of your karmas would have been successful. But because you are not omniscient, you do not know that a certain karma would produce a given result. What is the result would depend on so many unknown factors. Since you do not have choice over the result, you should recognize this limitation. This is the limitation in knowledge and power. All human beings have the same kind of limitation. The Lord says, do not be the cause of the result of the action. Ma karma paleshu, ma karma palahetu bhuhu. Because you are not. Do not be the cause of the result of the action because you are not. You are the cause of the karma only. But you are not the cause of the result thereof. You are the author of the actions only, but you are not the author of the results of those actions. Given this fact, the most appropriate thing for you is to take with an even attitude whatever result that comes to you. This is Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga implies the acceptance of Ishwar. Unless you accept Ishwar, there is no Karma Yoga. All results are taken care of by a certain law, which you may call the law of Dharma or the law of Karma. Whatever is the law that governs the karma and its results is the law of Karma. Whoever created this world also created this law of karma. Brahman created this world. Brahman is Ishwar, the Lord. The world is not separate from Ishwar. The laws are also his creation. The laws are also not separate from Ishwar. Hence, the laws are Ishwar. You have free will and you can do whatever you want to do, but the result is shaped by the law that is Ishwar. Therefore, you accept Ishwar first. And then you also accept him again as the karma phala dhata. When you do that, you have the attitude of a devotee, a bhakta. As a bhakta, you continuously confront Ishwar as you keep receiving the karma phala. Since every result comes from Ishwar, you take it as prasad, a blessing, a gift from Ishwar. When you view everything that happens to you as prasad, you have nothing to complain. Prasad never binds. Results which are not accepted as prasad bind. They bind you to karma and janma. Arjuna may well say now, if I have no control over the results of my actions, why should I not renounce action? Retreat to a forest and spend all my time in meditation, which is what I proposed a few minutes ago. The fact that you have no control over the fruits of your action, however, should not make you frustrated and stop all action. One should not renounce action out of frustration or fear. When you are afraid of something and you run away from it, then you have yielded to the immensity of the problem. When you run away from anything out of fear, it means that you still have raga dvesh. When you have raga dvesha still in your mind, you cannot give up action. You should not renounce action unless your mind is ready for it. When one gives up action out of fear, it is not sannyas. It becomes dereliction of duty. You just do not like an action and you want to escape from it. This is what the Lord refers here as inaction. Attachment to inaction is neither possible nor good. How can you live in this world without performing some action? Action is inescapable. However, neglecting to do what you have to do attracts sin. Yogastha kuru karmani Sangam tektva dhananjaya siddhya siddhyoho samabhutva samatvam yoga vuchyate. Arjun, being steadfast in yoga, perform actions giving up attachment, viewing alike success and failure. This evenness of mind is called karma yoga. Arjuna has a problem. To fight or not to fight. Every problem has a solution. But every solution too has a problem. If Arjuna fights this war, he will be forced to kill Bhishma, Drona and his cousins. If he retreats from the battlefield, he saves the lives of Bhishma, Drona and his cousins, no doubt, but he loses his reputation, which he built up painstakingly over the years. All the pain and sorrow that Arjuna has been experiencing is because he is unable to accept either of the two possible outcomes, victory or defeat, each having a problem attached to it. His agony ends, however, if he views the war as his duty, which he should perform without concern for victory or defeat. The Lord therefore says, Arjuna, ragadveshas which are behind all kamya karmas cause attachment to the results of action. This attachment to the outcome of the action is what is causing agony to you presently. You cannot get rid of your agony unless you get rid of your attachment to those results. You cannot get rid of the attachment unless you eliminate your ragadveshas first. Ragadveshas, likes and dislikes, would go away only if you perform karma with a proper attitude. This proper attitude is a prayerful attitude known as karma yoga. Yogastaha means abiding in yoga. Here yoga means karma yoga. The karma yogi is a mumukshu. A mumukshu is one who wants moksha. The karma yogi wants moksha, liberation, absolute freedom. Therefore he performs all karma as a yoga. In other words, he performs all karma as an offering to Ishwar, which is Ishwararpana Buddhi. The karma yogi also believes that all results of karma are given by Ishwar in accordance with the law of karma which he created. Therefore, he cheerfully accepts every result that comes to him as prasad from Ishwara, which is prasad buddhi. The Lord continues, when you start performing all karma as a yoga, in the beginning, you would encounter several roadblocks. Don't get discouraged by them. Persevere with vyavasayatmaka buddhi and become steadfast in yoga. With time, you will be able to purify your mind of all ragadveshas and gain the evenness of mind. With the advent of evenness of mind, you would stop viewing this battle in terms of victory and defeat. Evenness of mind is karma yoga. Durena shavaram karma buddhi yoga dhananjaya buddhau sharanam anvichcha kripanaha palahetavaha. Arjun, kami karma is very much inferior indeed to that performed with proper attitude. Therefore, seek refuge in the proper attitude. Those who perform karma for its fruits are misers. Desire motivated actions are called kami karmas. Kami karmas produce results in samsara. Almost all our actions are motivated by desires. We are happy when we get the desired result, unhappy otherwise. We do not know in advance what practice input is indeed needed for the desired result. We give input and hope that it is the right input. Invariably, it is a shot in the dark, which misses its target. Every action gets a result that it deserves. But most of us are not aware of this truth. Therefore, we do not get the desired results from our actions. We feel frustrated and miserable. Here, the problem lies actually not in our actions or in the results. Rather, it lies in our reaction to the results. However, when you perform all karma with a prayerful attitude and accept cheerfully every result that you get as prasad from the Lord, you gain an evenness of mind, which is the attitude of karma yoga. In karma yoga, we perform all karma with Ishwararpana Buddhi and accept all results with Prasada Buddhi. The attitude of karma yoga is the proper attitude for performing karma because it neutralizes the likes and dislikes, eliminates ragadveshas. As long as ragadvesha prompt your actions, it is not possible for you to gain that evenness of mind. When you gain the evenness of mind, you rise above sorrow and happiness. Karma returns you to samsara and its sorrows. Karma performed with the attitude of karma yoga neutralizes likes and dislikes and gives antakkarana shuddhi, which in turn leads to moksha. Clearly, therefore, kama karma is inferior to karma performed with the proper attitude of karma yoga. This is the reason why the Lord asked Arjuna to take refuge in karma yoga buddhi and perform karma as a duty and not for its results. He wants Arjuna to fight with the attitude of karma yoga, treating victory and defeat alike. Misers are those who have money but do not have the heart to spend it, either on themselves or on others. On this analogy, those who have buddhi but do not use it are called misers. Of all the Lord's creatures, human beings alone are endowed with buddhi, which is a discriminatory capacity. This is the greatest wealth one can have. It is given to the human beings so that by making proper use of it, they can gain self-knowledge. If one doesn't make proper use of this wealth, he is called a miser. People who perform karma for its results are misers, because they do not make proper use of their buddhi. If they make proper use of their buddhi, they would immediately come to know that karma performed for results returns one to samsara and its sorrow. And therefore, they would perform all karma with the attitude of karma yoga, which enables them to get liberation from samsara and its sorrows. Misers seek trivial results. Karma yogis and sannyasis seek moksha, which is a profound result. Arjuna wanted shreyas, which in the context of Bhagavad Gita is moksha. For gaining moksha, the Lord advises Arjuna to take refuge in karma yoga buddhi. Buddhi yukto jahatiha ubhe sukata duskrite tasmad yoga yujjasva yogaha karmasu kaushalam. One endowed with evenness of mind can get rid of both punyam and papam in this world itself. Therefore, commit yourself to karma yoga. Karma yoga is discretion in action. A buddhiyukta is one who is committed to the life of karma yoga. He has the buddhi or the attitude of karma yoga. Karma, when performed for the sake of self-purification and not for the sake of results in samsara, becomes a yoga. The karma yogi performs karma as an offering to Ishwar and accepts cheerfully every result that comes to him, no matter what it is, as prasad, a blessing from the Lord. This attitude to karma and its results neutralizes the raga dveshas and brings evenness of mind. This evenness of mind is only with reference to the results of action and not with reference to the action itself. Elimination of raga dvesha is also known as antakarna shuddhi. The ultimate goal of the karma yogi is moksha and not antakarna shuddhi. Antakarna shuddhi is an intermediate goal. Without antakarna shuddhi, however, moksha cannot happen. Arjuna wanted shreyas, which is moksha, but Arjuna had ragadvesha, and therefore he cannot gain moksha unless he eliminated ragadveshas first and gained antakarna shuddhi. For gaining antakarna shuddhi, Arjuna has to commit himself to karma yoga. He has no other option right now. Unlike the sannyasi, who is a jnani, the karma yogi has doership. Whoever has doership has to gain knowledge to shed his doership. To gain knowledge, one whose mind has ragadvesh has to perform karma as a yoga and eliminate his ragadvesh. Although a choice between karma yoga and sannyasi is a theoretical possibility for Arjuna, right now he is qualified only for karma yoga and not for sannyas, because he still has ragadvesha in his mind, which needed to be eliminated before he becomes qualified for sannyas. The karma yogi is a holy person of exemplary self-control. He gives up many things to gain mastery over his senses and mind, but he cannot give up doership. When you have doership, you cannot escape the results. Therefore, the karma yogi keeps accumulating punyam and papam. Very soon, after gaining antakarna shuddhi, however, the karma yogi also gains the knowledge of the self. This knowledge is gained only when the mind is purified. Mind becomes purified only when all the raga dveshas are eliminated. With the advent of the knowledge, the jiva discovers that he is the Brahman and gets liberated from karma and janma. This knowledge takes place when the jiva is still residing in the body. Knowledge cannot take place after the jiva leaves the body. Hence, the person gets liberated only when he is alive One who is liberated when alive is known as Jivan Mukta. The Jivan Mukta continues to live even after liberation on account of his prarabdha karma. The set of karmas that begins to fructify the moment the physical body is conceived is called the prarabdha karma. Any karma which has already begun has to run its full course. And therefore, the prarabdha karma which has already begun has to run its full course. The jiva therefore has to live and experience his prarabdha karma. He departs from the body only after he undergoes the full course of his prarabdha karma, and not an instant before that. Any further karma that the Jivan Mukta does after liberation, however, is like a burnt seed. It cannot generate results such as punyam and papa. When knowledge takes place, the jivatva vanishes, and what remains behind is the Atman, which is Brahman. The instant the jivatva disappears, the individual's punyam and papam account gets closed, because there is no more jiva in whose account the punyam papam can be held. Discretion, kaushala, skill in action is only with reference to choices involved for action. There is no discretion for giving up activity altogether for a karma yogi. For that matter, for anyone, not even for a jnani, no one can give up action totally and yet live in this world. Samatva is the evenness of mind. It is the capacity to be able to treat the opposites alike. Where samatva is with reference to the results of actions. Kaushala is with reference to actions themselves. Kaushala is your capacity to interpret correctly what is your dharma. This capacity to interpret properly with reference to one's dharma is a discretion, the skill. There is a particular order in creation which is sensed commonly, and this order dharma is the very basis upon which we are supposed to interact with our fellow beings. Dharma plays an important role in the choice of action for the karma yogi. Proper interpretation of dharma is what is meant by kaushala. Kaushala is yoga, because when you exercise your discretion to choose a particular action, you also choose at the same time to keep your raga dveshas away. Given a situation, any person with discrimination would be able to intuitively know what is dharma and what is adharma. This may be called common sense dharma. The person who is able to interpret what is to be done in any given situation at a given time and place in terms of dharma has kaushala. No product is separate from the material of which it is made. The chain cannot be separate from the gold from which it is made. Therefore, the creation is non-separate from the creator, who is both its efficient cause as well as its material cause. The law of dharma, being part of the creation, is also non-separate from Ishvara, its creator. Thus, dharma is considered Ishvara by the karma yogi. When one looks upon dharma as a lord, one worships the lord by doing what is to be done at any given time and place. If you do what you should do, you are in harmony with Ishvara. This is the law of dharma that governs all karma, which is yoga, karma su kaushalam. Recognizing this truth, you become a karma yogi. This attitude results in antakkarana shuddhi. Karmajam buddhi yukta hi phalam tyaktva manishinaha janma bandha vidarmuktaha padam gacchanti namayam. The wise karma yogis, renouncing the fruits of actions and becoming free from the shackles of birth, attain the state which is free from affliction. We shall continue this verse next class. Chant the name of the Lord and His glory unceasingly, that the mirror of the heart may be wiped clean and quenched with mighty forest fire, worldly lust raging furiously within, own name streamed down in moonlight on the lotus heart, opening its cup to knowledge of thyself, O self drowned deep in the waves of his bliss, tasting his nectar at every step, bathing in his name for that bath for various souls. Various are thy names, O Lord, in each and every name thy power resides. No times are set, no rites are needful for chanting of thy name. So vast is thy mercy, how huge then is my wretchedness, who find in this empty life and heart no devotion to thy name. O my mind, be humbler than a blade of grass, be patient and forbearing like a tree, take no honor to thyself, give honor to all, chant unceasingly the name of the Lord. O Lord and soul of the universe, minds of prayer for wealth threaten you. The playthings of lust or ties of fame. As many times as I may be reborn, grant me, O Lord, a steadfast love for thee. A drowning man in this world, in this world's fearful ocean, is thy servant, O sweet one. In thy mercy, consider him as just beneath thy feet. Oh, how I long for the day when an instant separation from thee, O Lord, will be as a thousand years, when my heart burns with its desire, and the world without thee is a heartless wild. Prostrate at thy feet, let me be in unwavering devotion, neither imploring the embrace of thine arms, nor bewailing the withdrawal of thy presence, though it tears my soul asunder. O thou, who stillest the hearts of thy devotees, do with me what thou wilt, for thou art my heart's beloved, thou and thou alone. O Lord, lead us from the unreal to the real, lead us from darkness to light, and lead us from death to immortality. May all be free from dangers, may all realize what is good, may all be actuated by noble thoughts, may all rejoice everywhere. May all be happy, may all be free from disease, may all realize what is good, may none be subject to misery. May the wicked become virtuous, may the virtuous attain tranquility, may the tranquil be free from bonds, may the freed make others free. May good be at all people, may the sovereign righteously rule the earth, may all beings ever attain what is good, may the worlds be prosperous and happy, may the clouds pour rain in time, may the earth be blessed with crops, may all countries be freed from calamity, may holy men live without fear. May the Lord, the destroyer of sins, the presiding deity of all sacred works, be satisfied, for he being pleased, the whole universe becomes pleased, he being satisfied, the whole universe feels satisfied.